College, I moved to North Carolina, the epicenter of NASCAR racing, to pursue my racing career. I was definitely the odd one out. Not only was I a female driver in a male-dominated sport, but I was also what seemed like the only vegetarian and now vegan in the state of North Carolina. I had a few people in NASCAR tell me that this must be the reason I'm so short. The lack of meat in my diet must have stunted my growth. It's safe to say that it was difficult for some of the old school NASCAR boys to take seriously a vegetarian female driver as a competitor. But it was about to get much worse because soon it was not just my diet and my gender that was setting me apart from the rest of the racing community. Over the years, like everyone here today, I've become increasingly concerned about the damage that's being done to our environment. In 2006, I took my personal concerns public when I started a section on my racing website dedicated to environmental news. And in 2007, I announced my commitment to adopt and protect an acre of rainforest every time I sat in my race car to offset my carbon footprint. I know that offsetting is not a solution, but I had to do something about the unavoidable emissions of my job. The more that I learned about our environmental challenges, the more that my racing site became covered in eco-facts about renewable energy and electric cars and alternative fuels and green buildings and plant-based diets and environmental legislation. And the reaction that I got from the racing community and the general public was very strong from both sides of the fence. I remember coming across an argument that had started on a NASCAR forum. This is back in 2006. One member of the forum was very annoyed with me that I was promoting a movie that's called An Inconvenient Truth on my website. He called me all kinds of names and said that I was brainwashed by Al Gore. Another member questioned how he could judge the movie if he hadn't actually seen it. The thread became very long and people were arguing back and forth. Some people liked me, some people hated me, but both sides were posting with passion. And when I got past the personal attacks on myself, I sat back and thought, wow, I just started an argument about global warming on a NASCAR forum. I guarantee you that this was the first time the people on that racing forum had argued about the parts per million of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere. And that made me smile. I had started a dialogue, and that is the first step in creating change, to start a dialogue between the two sides. And that very simple thing became something very important to me. I had become a bridge between the environmentalists and the race fans, and even if some people didn't like me for it, what was happening on that NASCAR forum was bigger than my racing career. I ended up becoming more of an activist than a driver. I began lobbying for clean energy on Capitol Hill. I traveled twice to the BP oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. And so far, I have made 3 trips to Taiji, Japan, spending several weeks recording the horrific dolphin slaughter exposed in the Academy Award-winning documentary, The Cove. I was told by many people in the racing world that I was making a big mistake. That as a driver, I needed to shut up, plug my sponsors, and drive the race car. Marketing people warned me that by speaking out about environmental and political issues, that I would alienate myself from companies that might want to sponsor my car. And you know what I told them? I said the same thing that I had said many years earlier to the people that told me that girls can't drive race cars. I said, screw you, watch me. I had made a very important decision, and that was what I was going to talk about, what I believed in, even if it landed me on the sidelines of the racetrack. I had finally made it to a level in my sport where my races were airing on TV, and I knew that I would be a fool to waste that opportunity. So if a sponsor didn't want to work with me because I promote caring about the planet, then thanks, but no thanks. I don't want you on my race car anyway. I drew that line in the sand, something cool started to happen. I started to get calls from people who believed in the same things that I do. In 2007, when I became the 4th woman in history to race in the Indy Pro Series, I had a company named Smart Papers on my race car. They are a leader in the recycled paper industry. I've raced for Operation Free, which is a coalition of veterans that are fighting for clean energy in Washington, D.C., and trying to get out the message to mainstream America that our $1 billion-a-day habit on foreign oil is a national security threat to this country. At Daytona this past February, I drove the first ever ocean awareness race car carrying the colors of the Oscar-winning documentary The Cove. The car was funded completely by the passion of individuals that had seen this film, which I believe is the best documentary ever made. A couple of years ago, one of my sponsors, a renewable energy company called Native Energy, was criticized for their support. A disgruntled customer complained, "You're promoting race car driving?" Tom Rawls, the VP of marketing, responded on their website by saying this: "How does Native Energy reach people who are not already converts on the issue of climate change? Anyone who is engaged in any broad effort to speak to the public faces this question: do I talk only to friendly audiences, or do I face the doubters and the hostiles? If we only address those who already agree with us, then nothing changes. And if we only work with people who already believe in the same things that we do, then who is going to change the minds of those who don't?" So this is my call to action for you today. I want everyone here that is in the environmental movement to start thinking outside the eco box. And instead of talking to each other, I want you to go out and talk to people who aren't on board yet. It is a more difficult conversation to have, but it is also the most important conversation to have. This is how we move the needle, and this is how we create change. I have seen that change firsthand. I have had a lifelong NASCAR fan ask me about how I go about adopting my acre of rainforest because he didn't know what to get his wife for her birthday, and he thought giving her an acre of rainforest in her name would make a pretty nice gift. Just because these fans love racing does not mean that they don't care about the earth. Liking fast cars and caring about the environment are not mutually exclusive events. Tesla and Fisker are two sports cars built for people like me who love fun cars but also don't want to burn fossil fuels. Auto racing is the number one spectator sport in America. It is number two on television, second only to the NFL. More people tune in to watch racing than basketball, baseball, and hockey combined, and 18 of the top 20 attended sporting events in this country are auto races. 17 of them are NASCAR races, and one of them is the Indy 500. Nearly one in three Americans considers themselves a race fan, which is also why more Fortune 500 companies sponsor NASCAR than any other sport. So I am now on a mission to green my sport. Imagine a race car without logos asking fans to buy something, but instead calling to action millions of fans, inspiring them to make a difference. I call it my 200-mile-per-hour eco-awareness program. Each time my race car hits the track, I send environmental messages to the fans, whether it's about clean energy, plant-based diets, or saying no to plastic. With over 7 billion people on the planet and a growth rate of almost 275,000 people every single day, our day-to-day decisions have become very important. Small changes, multiplied by billions, make a big difference. I hope that my efforts will encourage the sanctioning bodies to increase their environmental initiatives, and I will not stop until I see every racetrack with a recycling program, every sponsor taking responsibility for their effect on their environment, every racing tire recycled, and every race car running on 100% clean, renewable fuels. This is my mission. And some people think I'm crazy, and I know this because they send me emails. But when I get discouraged, I remember these words from an old Apple Think Different commercial. Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs and the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them, but the one thing that you can't do is ignore them. because they change things. They push the human race forward, and while some may see them as crazy, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think that they can change the world are the ones who do.